Delhi is one of the most ancient cities of the world. Empires were built on it and destroyed and then rebuilt by others. All these dramatic events have left their mark on the fabric of the city. The Rajputs, Turks, Afghans, Mughals, and the British all fought for the possession of Delhi. They built their forts and palaces and often settled down permanently. Before long, however, they were replaced by others. Delhi assimilated them all and remained impassive to the vicissitudes of fortune, survived invasions, plunder, and massacres, and yet, like the mythical phoenix, rose again in new splendor. Its history is no less the story of India's than it is the history of the whole of Asia. For centuries, its splendor turned the heads of the Western world. If Rome was the center of ancient Europe, Delhi was the metropolis of Asia. The city has been the coveted capital of many empires. Battles over its possession have left it a mere skeleton of its former splendor, but enough remains to bear testimony to its rich and glorious past. If there is any place in India which presents a panorama of 3,000 years of continuous habitation and centuries of architectural activity, it is Delhi. Between 1857 and 1911, the British functioned from Calcutta as their capital, but in 1911, that changed. Delhi once again regained its former status and became the capital of British India, and a new city was built outside the walled city of the Mughals, New Delhi. It was believed that he who held Delhi held and ruled India, its strategic position making it the most logical choice. Thus it came about that as well as being the administrative capital during the British Empire, it also became the center of one of the great innovations of the Victorian era, the age of the steam railway. Railways were introduced into the country in 1853, the same year as the telegraph system. The British laid 62,000 kilometers of track throughout India, with the first line opening on the Great Indian Peninsula Railway between Bombay City and Tana in April 1853. Though the Raj is no more, the romance of the golden age of rail travel still lives on in India. The Indian Railways, in conjunction with the Rajasthan Tourist Board, produced a train to resurrect a glamorous past age. The Palace on Wheels. The original train was assembled from appropriate coaches, unearthed from sources throughout the subcontinent, many rusting away in obscure sidings. Most of them were once owned by the now deposed Maharajas. Restored to their former magnificence, they became the pride of the Indian railways. However, in 1995, the old train was decommissioned, only to be replaced by a brand new one designed to travel on India's broad gauge track. We met the train at Delhi's cantonment station, which was to be the starting point for a seven-night adventure through India's state of palaces and fairy tale cities, Rajasthan. A journey described by the operators as a week in Wonderland. Thank you. As the passengers are greeted in the train's own waiting lounge, they are given a traditional Indian welcome, a garland of fresh flowers and the customary red mark on the forehead. The greeting ceremony over, and the passengers are escorted to the train and to their respective carriages. 70 or so strangers from countries as far afield as Canada, the United States, Korea, Great Britain, Germany, and even some from India itself, all about to share a unique and once-in-a-lifetime experience. A luxurious and opulent adventure in a style that was previously enjoyed by India's elite maharajas. For the next 7 days, they were going to live in regal splendor aboard India's traveling palace, the Palace on Wheels. With the passengers now on board and settled into their cabins, the Palace on Wheels pulls gently out of Delhi, traveling overnight to its first port of call in the fascinating state of Rajasthan. Rajasthan sits in the north of India and borders with Pakistan. This is the home of the ancient Rajput princes and warriors, and age-old palaces, citadels, and fortified cities. It's early morning, and we have arrived at the city of Jaipur. Having enjoyed breakfast, the passengers disembark to begin a tour of the city in a luxury air-conditioned coach. Waiting at the station to greet them is a most unusual sight. Perhaps we should have taken this as a clue to what to expect later that morning. But to most, it was enjoyed as Jaipur's ceremonial welcome and the first part in the kaleidoscope jigsaw of colors and sights which make up the Indian experience. Jaipur, known for obvious reasons as the Pink City, is the capital of Rajasthan and is a charming mixture of the old and the new. It was painted pink for a state visit of the Prince of Wales in 1883, pink being the traditional Indian colour for welcome, and the buildings of Jaipur have remained this colour ever since. A strange blend of exotic medieval architecture sits amongst the modern setting. The street life is chaotic, yet somehow organised. Women folk decked in silver jewellery and bright coloured swirling skirts proudly promenade amid snake charmers and street merchants. It should be said that for a first-time visitor to this country, some of the sights of Indian street life can be initially distressing. Beggars can be a nuisance, but armed with a few 10-rupee notes sporadically distributed to ease one's own conscience, it is something you soon become accustomed to, even if you don't fully comprehend it. This is Jaipur's world-famous landmark, the Palace of the Winds, a remarkable five-story structure which forms part of the city palace. It was designed for the royal ladies as a place where they could watch the processions on the street, looking out from behind the small lattice windows without fear of being seen by the common man. Just outside of the city, we stopped to take in the magnificent view of the water palace of Jal Mahal. This building, as palatial as it first appears, is in fact only a facade which was built for the Singh dynasty in the early 17th century as a hide for duck shooting. Further up the hill, we reach Amber Fort, a grand and imposing medieval structure which preceded the city of Jaipur. This was once the capital of the Mina tribes, believed to be the original inhabitants of this area. It was here that we learned the significance of the elephant that greeted us on the station platform. These gaily painted caparisoned elephants were the means on which we would climb the steep winding road leading up to the fort. As the great lumbering beasts slowly edge their way up the narrow track, one couldn't help thinking that riding an elephant in this way can only be likened to riding a roller coaster backwards. There was one consolation, however, the promise from the guide that we would be taken back down the hill in four-wheel drive vehicles. Our perilous journey, however, was well worth suffering, for once we got inside the fort gates, we truly realized that we had been transported back in time. Amber Fort is a spectacular mix of massive gateways, courtyards, stairways, and pillared pavilions and palaces. It was Man Singh I who fortified the original structure left over from the Mughals. This grand courtyard, Jaleb Chowk, is where the vast armies would line up and parade before marching out to war. The double-story pavilions, rows of rooms and high walls surrounding it, lend grandeur to the whole setting. From the walls of the fort, one gets a magnificent view over the whole of the city of Jaipur. Amber Fort is overlooked by the Calico Hills, where a few deserted grand mansions of chiefs, councillors, and dignitaries stand clinging to their slopes. A narrow path descends into the valley, where ruins of the ancient amber can still be seen in derelict temples and decaying houses and sunken courtyards. Crumbling stone walls lie beside the small antennae-topped houses which have mushroomed all around. The journey back down the hill was, as promised, by four-wheel drive. However, by comparison, most of the passengers would rather have chanced their luck on the elephants. It was by now lunchtime, and in keeping with the splendor of the train, we are taken to another palace. This is the Rambagh Palace, once the home of Ram Singh II, the Maharaja who unfortunately died playing polo in England in the early 1970s. As with most of these grand palaces throughout India, when independence came and their powers and wealth were taken away, the Maharajas leased their homes back to the government to provide a moderate income. Most of them became grand hotels, and the Rambagh Palace Hotel, with its sprawling bright green lawns, is one of the finest in Rajasthan. Greeted with the traditional welcome, the passengers from the Palace on Wheels ate lunch in one of the grand banqueting halls. The decor is typically Rajasthani and gives a glimpse of the splendor that surrounded the lives of Jaipur's Maharajas. Our next stop on the tour of the city was Jantar Mantar. To a visitor uninitiated in the sciences of astronomy and astrology, the various stone and marble instruments built near the city palace might appear interesting but confusing.
So now main function is this, that we can get the position of the sun. Sun is on which part of zodiac sign? So today sun is on Scorpio. You can see the ring shadow on the marble slab there, and the general Hindi there, the Scorpio. Now six zodiac sign, you can see in the southern hemisphere, six northern.
Looking like a set for a science fiction movie, these instruments are the most precise modes of studying the movements of the sun and calculations of time. These futuristic instruments, measuring all aspects of the sun's movements, were built between 1728 and 1734 by Sawai Jai Singh II, who was a great scholar of astronomy. The Samrat Yantra is the most accurate instrument at the observatory and is in fact at 90 feet high, the largest sundial in the world. Today, these ancient yet precise instruments are used by the people of Jaipur who come here to predict important dates, such as the perfect wedding day. The final stop in Jaipur was to see the city palace, which overlooks the observatory. The city palace, or Chandra Mahal, forms the core of Jaipur. The private residential quarters are concealed behind high walls and imposing gateways. Passing through the rhinoceros gate, you enter a courtyard surrounded by double-story rows of rooms with balconies. In the center stands Mubarak Mahal, an exquisite guest house designed like a jewelry box. This now houses the Palace Textile Museum. Sarhad Ki Diori is the magnificent gateway to the palace itself, with its splendid polished bronze door and its central arch flanked by the palace guards and two elephant statues in white marble. Beyond this gate is yet another courtyard, at the center of which stands the Diwan Ikas, a double row of marble pillars supporting engrailed arches. The palace itself stands majestically on the northern side. The city palace, although now open in parts to the public, retains apartments which are still in use today by the present ex-Maharaja, Lieutenant Colonel Bhawani Singh. By now, it is late afternoon and time to rejoin our train still waiting at Jaipur station. As the train sits on the platform and the sun sets over Jaipur, the passengers are dressing for dinner. Dinner this evening is being served in another of Jaipur's fine hotels, the Palace Hotel. It is a warm evening, and dinner is laid out in the hotel gardens. Entertained by local performers, the passengers have plenty of time to relax and get to know one another, sharing the end of the first day and the first part of the Indian experience. With all the passengers safely back on board after a long but enchanting day, the Palace on Wheels slips out of Jaipur en route to Chittorgarh. From Jaipur, we travel south overnight to the city of Chittorgarh, and then we'll continue our journey by motor coach westward to the city of Udaipur. Chittorgarh station on day 3 of our journey. There were no elephants to greet the palace on wheels this time. There were, however, two Indian lancers on horseback. These splendid chargers were significant because Chittorgarh is steeped in tales of victory and valor in Rajasthan's sometimes violent history. This massive fortified settlement, which still to this day houses 5,000 inhabitants, has been ravaged 3 times in its eventful history, and is Rajasthan's principal fortress. Alauddin Khilji was the first to invade Chittor in 1303 AD. He was driven by an overwhelming desire to possess the fort's regal beauty, Queen Padmini. Legend has it that the fort had been held under siege for 6 months, and the queen offered a consolation of showing her face to the aggressor, but only in the reflection of a mirror. Struck by the queen's mesmerizing beauty, Alauddin attacked the fort. But the noble queen preferred death to dishonor, and while the men rode out dressed in the saffron robes of martyrdom to engage the enemy, the queen and the womenfolk of the fort committed jauhar, suicide, by throwing themselves on a huge funeral pyre. This amazing act of self-sacrifice happened again in 1533 and in 1567, with the Rajput warriors displaying true chivalry under attack and the women committing jauhar. After the third attack, Chittor was razed to rubble, leaving few of the palaces and structures intact, save those you can still see today. This is the Victory Tower, a nine-story building, 37 meters high, built in 1440 AD. This is Padmini's Palace, built beside one of the fort's many pools. It was here, in this pavilion, that she showed a glimpse of her face through the mirror. This is the spot where she and 1,200 other women committed jauhar. In 1567, when the Mughal emperor attacked Chittor for the third time in its history, the then incumbent Uday Singh decided that discretion was preferred to valor for his people, so he fled to establish a new capital. And it was there that we traveled to for the next part of the day's adventure, Udaipur. Known as the City of Dawn, Udaipur is built around clear blue lakes and overlooked by the lush hills of the Avralis. Udaipur is a fascinating blend of sights, sounds and experiences, and an inspiration for the imagination of poets, painters and writers. Possibly the city's most spectacular sight, and perhaps one of India's most famous picture book scenes, is the elegant Jag Nivas, built in 1746 on Lake Pichola as the then ruler's summer residence. The Jag Nivas, which can only be approached by a boat, is now, under the new government legislation, the Lake Palace Hotel. The Palace on Wheels passengers are treated to a sumptuous lunch here in the lush setting of this splendid edifice, possibly one of the finest settings for any hotel in the world. For the same price as any other fine hotel in India, guests can stay in what was once the Maharaja's private suite, complete with its own indoor swing. From the hotel terrace, you can see the grand city palace of Udaipur, and it was there that we were taken after lunch to continue our adventure through this wonderland. The city palace is a labyrinth of courtyards, pavilions and terraces surrounded by crenellated walls. The main entrance is through the triple arch gate, the Tripolia, with eight marble porticos. This was a palace built for a Maharana, one step up the regal ladder from a Maharaja. The Suraj Gokada, or the Balcony of the Sun, is where the Surya Vanshi Maharanas of Mewar presented themselves to the people in times of trouble to restore their confidence. This is the Crystal Gallery, undoubtedly one of the most exclusive tea rooms in the world. We arrived back at our train in the early hours of the evening. Time for the passengers to sit and enjoy a pre-dinner drink before sampling some of the train's exquisite culinary delights.
Did you see the suite at Lake Palace with a swing in it? We told them the honeymoon couple, if the swing doesn't work, go to the Palace of Mirrors.
So I'm very happy to be able to go back to something. Yes, I will go back.
You know, it's an adventure, it's quite a learning experience, it's very enriching. It's a kind of experience that one has to have, you know, if you want to know what it is. It's not something you can read from a book. Like I can read about a cruise, you know, going to anywhere, and I can see the menu, you know, imagine what kind of food, what kind of service. But as far as experiencing what you see, feel, you know, interacting with people, that's you can only do that by doing this kind of trip.
The Palace on Wheels once again slips away into the night. We are now travelling eastward, toward the city of Sawai Modhopur, a journey that will take us 7 hours. Day 4 of our adventure. We are in the station of Sawai Modhopur. This morning's excitement is a trip in four-wheel drive trucks to one of India's finest game reserves, the Ranthambore National Park. Spread over an area of 392 square kilometers of thick forest with lush vegetation and waterfalls, the park is home for over 300 different species of birds and mammals. The center of the reserve is located amidst the imposing ruins of a 10th century fort. We were told by our guide that the early morning was the best time to visit the park, because that was when animals came out to feed. Driving through the forest, we hoped that we might just catch a glimpse of a jackal or hyena, but in view of the fact that we were driving around in noisy diesel motor-driven trucks, it appeared doubtful. No wild animal in its right mind would surely come near a group of camera-flashing tourists, and many of the passengers felt that perhaps this was part of the trip that was going to be a disappointment compared to what they'd experienced over the previous few days. But that was where we were wrong. Suddenly, the driver stops the truck and points. In the bushes, we could just make out the vivid markings of a tiger. It was just as though he couldn't have cared whether we were there watching him or not. And this was a tiger living in the wild, not one that was caged up in a zoo, used to seeing humans every day. This was no timid animal. Before we knew it, the tiger boldly walked out from the bush and strolled along in front of our vehicle before crossing the track and then disappearing again into the bush. Arriving back at the train mid-morning, we had a couple of hours to spend before the train was due to pull out. Some of the passengers decided to take a walk along the platform and venture out for themselves, away from the reins of the train staff. As we wandered amongst the platforms, watching the daily routine of a typical Indian railway station, although it was more than apparent that some of these people lived well below the so-called poverty line, and in fact, most of them probably wouldn't even know what level of comfort constituted the poverty line, there was never at any time any feeling of threat or danger, and one felt quite safe. We were obviously a privileged few travelling on such a luxury train. For although the Indian Railway boasts one, if not the most efficient rail network in the world, first appearances of regular Indian trains do not exude such opulence as this one. By noon, our train was ready to embark on the next part of the journey. This next leg would take us due west, travelling almost the width of Rajasthan to the desert city of Jaisalmer, close to the border with Pakistan. Unlike the previous days, we would be travelling through the daytime, and for the first time on this adventure, you really do feel as though you're travelling in a bygone era, the golden age of rail. For there is really no better way of seeing a country than watching it unfurl through the windows of a train. For the rest of the day, There would be no hurry, no pressure to see the next site or landmark. Just time to eat, sleep, and relax, and think of the wondrous sights you had already set eyes on. Time to read, maybe, in the quiet and tranquility of the train's bar car and lounge, with its lavish, comfortable seating and well-stocked bar. Or take a leisurely lunch in one of the train's two restaurant cars, aptly named the Maharaja and the Maharana. For some passengers, it was time to relax in the comfort of their own cabins, some of which have twin beds, whilst others have double beds. Accommodation on board the train is not as cramped as one would expect, although you can book a twin cabin which will take up to four berths. At the end of each carriage, which contains four cabins, there's an exclusive lounge area with seating for up to eight people. Each carriage has two personal attendants who are on hand at all times to cater for your every need. Halfway through this wondrous journey, through a country strewn with fairy tale cities and grand palaces, one thought it would be impossible to see India any other way. We had seen so much in such a short space of time, with still a great deal more to see and do. It would not be possible by air, and if you traveled by road, it would take a great deal longer. This has to be the best way for a first-time visitor to see this country. You see all of the wondrous sights, you stay in five-star accommodation with all amenities, you are cosseted with the safety of the train and its ever-diligent staff, and nothing is left to chance. On top of which, you are treated like a Maharaja. For one guest, there was a special celebration, his 70th birthday. It's day five of our adventure into the wonderland of Rajasthan, and we have arrived at the platform of Jaisalmer. Hundreds of the local townsfolk were waiting to greet the train and its complement of passengers. Rising from the heart of the Thar Desert like a golden mirage is the city of Jaisalmer. The land of the Bhati princes, born of the moon, is by far the oldest of the ancient capitals of Rajasthan and dates back to 1156 AD. A commanding fort etched in yellow sandstone stands with all its awesome splendor, dominating the city. Known as the Golden City, Jaisalmer has for many years remained untouched by outside influences. Bharti Rajputs of Jaisalmer were feudal chiefs who lived off enforced levies on the caravans laden with precious silks and spices that crossed the territory en route to Delhi or Sindh. These caravans earned the city great wealth, making it one of the most thriving places in Rajasthan. Much of the entire township is housed within the ramparts of the fort, perched high on the Trikuta Hill. The rise of the shipping trade and the nearby port of Mumbai saw the decline of Jaisalmer, but the desert fortress that seems to be straight out of the tales of the Arabian Nights, even today, never fails to enchant visitors to this wondrous city. Down below, life within the citadel conjures up images of medieval majesty, visible in its winding narrow lanes, strewn with palaces, havelis, temples, and the city's skilled artisans. Jaisalmer is the place to buy the very best quality cashmere scarves or hand-embroidered silk wraps. One of the most significant features of Jaisalmer is the abundance of havelis, The city is strewn with these magnificent mansion houses, all with their intricate hand-carved stone latticework. The three most prominent of the havelis are the Natalmi Ki Haveli, a late 19th century structure. The left and right wings were carved by two brothers. Both produced very similar work, balanced in design, but not identical. The Patwan Ki Haveli, the most elaborate and magnificent of all the Jaisalmer Havelis, has exquisitely carved pillars and extensive corridors and chambers. The third is Salim Singh Ki Haveli. This building is 300 years old and was home to Maharaja Rawai Gai Singh, Jaisalmer's Prime Minister. These extraordinary yellow stone mansions are covered with intricate carvings. It is hard to believe that the human hand is capable of executing the intricate stone carvings on these structures. From the top of the fort, we could see the palace on wheels waiting at the station platform. This was going to be one of the days that we enjoyed lunch aboard the train. By late afternoon, the passengers embarked on another part of the Jaisalmer experience, without which one's visit to this area would be incomplete. We are taken to the picturesque sand dunes of Sam. The journey across this surreal desert landscape, rippled and patterned by the wind, was to be made by camel. This was truly a step back in time. One pictured these nomads in earlier civilizations, great movements of people, crossing the subcontinent on the back of a camel. In 1897, Mark Twain described India as the land of dreams and romance, of fabulous wealth and fabulous poverty, of splendor and rags, of palaces and hovels, of famine and pestilence, of genii and giants and Aladdin lamps, of tigers and elephant, of cobras and jungle, of camels and desert. The country of 100 nations and 100 tongues, of 1,000 religions and 2 million gods. As the passengers from the palace on wheels relish in the brief desert experience, enjoying the customary afternoon tea, they gather to watch the sun go down on this magical land, set amidst the beauty of the desolate desert landscape. The English journalist James Cameron, one of India's greatest advocates, summed up this subcontinent's appeal wonderfully when he wrote, "I like the evening in India, the one magic moment when the sun balances on the rim of the world and the hush descends." Illuminated by the glow from the campfires, the passengers end this perfect day and end the adventure into the deserts of Rajasthan, dining under the canopy of the starlit sky. The palace on wheels heads west, towards the center of Rajasthan, traveling overnight to the blue city, Jodhpur. Set at the edge of the Thar Desert, the imperial city of Jodhpur echoes with tales of antiquity in the emptiness of the desert. Once the capital of the Marwar state, it was founded in 1459 by Rao Jodha, chief of the Rathor clan of Rajputs, who claimed to be descendants of Rama, the epic hero of the Ramayana. The massive 15th century Marangara fort looms on the top of a rocky hill, soaring 125 meters above the plains. The city is encompassed by a high wall, 10 kilometers long, with 8 gates and innumerable bastions. Sitting majestically at the foot of the road to the fort is Jaswant Tada. This is Jodhpur's burial ground. Built in 1899, in memory of Maharaja Jaswant Singh II, this white marble construction houses a collection of royal cenotaphs. Within the main cenotaph, a gallery houses the portraits of various Jodhpur rulers. The road from the Jaswant Tada leads to the four gates of the fort. This 5 kilometer long majestic structure is one of Rajasthan's most impressive and formidable bastions. Looking over the city, one can see the array of blue painted houses that gave rise to the city being called the Blue City. Within the fortress itself, almost impregnable with its steep access road and four large gates, are some magnificent sights to behold. At the entrance to the fort is this plaque. These are the stone handprints of the city's many princesses and womenfolk whose husbands had died in battle. They all committed the act of sati, a self-sacrificial practice now banned in India. Within the fort are some magnificent palaces with beautifully carved panels, latticed windows, and evocative names. These include the Moti Mahal, the Phool Mahal, the Sheesh Mahal, the Sili Khana, and the Daulat Khana. These palaces house a fabulous collection of trappings of Indian royalty. Lunch this day was provided at the Umaid Bhawan Palace. Maharaja Umaid Singh, a great hunter in the 20th century, built this palace over 16 years to create employment under the Famine Relief Project. It was one of the most decadent and largest private homes ever constructed throughout the world. This opulent edifice in sandstone is still the residence of the former rulers, with a part of it running as a hotel and the remainder as a museum. Having enjoyed a splendid lunch, it was time to rejoin the Palace on Wheels. We were going to travel through the afternoon and night westward to the city of Agra. As the sun set, the passengers had moved into the bar car for the evening's entertainment. By now, having spent 6 days together, everybody knew everybody.
We said if we wanted to marry, we take this train and make our honeymoon on the Palace on Wheels.
It's an adventure, and I think one of the things that has been so interesting about this visit are the people that we've met aboard the train and the sharing of stories. And the uncanny sort of matching that happens. And as it turns out, there are friends of friends that we've connected with, and over a course of drinks and conversation, it becomes a kind of a network of friends that you've met at other places and other times, and it's quite awesome, actually. It's very interesting.
As beautiful as Rajasthan is, I was motivated to bring two of my very special friends from the United States to show them India. And I'd heard of this train journey that takes care of all the trips to the romantic places, and I felt, well, this would take care of that. And I felt what I saw was fulfilled me beyond my expectations.
Well, outside the train, you know, you get approached by all the children, and so we knew that, and you expect that. And it's a different world, inside and outside, of course. But yet you do have the experience you need to have to travel in a country like this. And on the other hand, you're in a safe haven when you walk in here. You know, you feel secure, you feel nice. And it's quite an experience.
With the sun rising on day 7, it is the last full day of our adventure. We're at the station of Bharatpur, 55 kilometers from Agra and the eastern gateway to Rajasthan. Today is starting with a visit to the finest bird sanctuary in Asia, the Kila Dayalgana National Park. Once the royal hunting reserve of the princes of Bharatpur, this sanctuary is inundated with over 400 species of wild aquatic birds. Exotic migrators from Afghanistan, Central Asia and Tibet, as well as the Siberian cranes from the Arctic, grey-legged geese from Siberia and the bar-headed geese from China. There are colonies of cormorants, parakeets, spoonbills, storks, egrets, herons, pelicans, ibis and grey herons, which can be seen all over the park. Following the visit to the bird sanctuary, the group moves on to the sandstone fort of Fatehpur Sikri. Built by the Emperor Akbar, the palaces, pavilions and mosques of Fatehpur Sikri reflect the power of the once mighty Mughal Empire. It was here at Sikri that Akbar, a diplomat par excellence, held court with Islamic, Hindu and Jesuit priests and missionaries. As one enters from the Agra gate, the first building encountered is the Diwan-e-Am. This is where Akbar would sit in public audience, listen to petitions or dispense justice. In front of the royal seat is a hook to which, according to legend, Akbar tethered his pet elephant, Hiran. It was said that offenders were put beneath the elephant's feet to be crushed to death. If the elephant refused to obey his master 3 times, the victim was freed, so expressing the will of God. On the western line of this courtyard stands Panch Mahal, a 5-storied pavilion. This is a Persian wind tower where harem ladies could come to enjoy the cool breeze. At the southern end lies Anup Talo, the water tank, where on its central platform, the legendary Tansen, Akbar's court musician, would perform. Jodhabai's palace is a high-walled, somber-looking edifice guarded by an impressive gateway. This was the harem quarters. Beyond the gate in a massive courtyard is the mosque, built on the highest point of the ridge. The courtyard could accommodate 10,000 worshippers. The eastern gate was used by royalty. This is the only white marble structure at Fatehpur Sikri. the tomb of Sheikh Salim Chisti. These are the Jali screens, exquisite pieces of the highest craftsmanship, each screen being carved from one single slab of marble. The original crypt of the Sheikh lies within the chamber, and those visitors who wish for a child come here to pray. They tie a red thread on the Jali, then come again once their wish is granted. After 15 years, soon after building this tomb, Fatehpur Sikri was abandoned by Akbar, some say because the saint had died and the emperor felt lonely without his presence. But although the city was abandoned in 1585, the tomb was not, and it still remains today as the living heart of the structure. Our final destination of this journey through Rajasthan was a visit to the ancient city of Agra, home of one of the seven wonders of the world, and the highlight for many of this whole adventure. This is the building's entranceway, a truly magnificent portal through which thousands of visitors pour every day of the year, rain or shine. Tourists, newlyweds, the old, the young, the rich, the poor, flock here to see one of the most beautiful, most romantic, most enigmatic, and most photographed buildings in the world, the Taj Mahal. Completed in 1652, this amazing achievement of an emperor inspired by love for his dead queen remains just as enchanting today. Emperor Shah Jahan promised his queen Mumtaz Mahal, who lay on her deathbed after giving birth to the 14th child, two things. He would have no more children, and the most beautiful memorial ever built by man for his loved one. Within 6 months of her death, he had brought her body to Agra, where it was given a temporary resting ground near the river. Shah Jahan started work. He personally supervised 20,000 men who, using the finest white marble, cornelian, turquoise, malachite, diamonds and onyx from all over the world, constructed the memorial within 12 years. Shah Jahan's remains now lie alongside his queen in the Taj itself, a monument to eternal love. Waiting for the sun to set on this amazing structure, seeing its color change from white to an orange glow, the passengers from the palace on wheels are awestruck. A perfect and fitting end to the journey of a lifetime. Our final morning on the palace on wheels. We had arrived back in Delhi from Agra during the early hours of the morning. As everyone says their goodbyes, we say farewell to the wonderland of Rajasthan, the land of deserts, maharajas, lakes and palaces, and to one palace in particular, a palace which had become our traveling home for 7 days and 7 nights, the Palace on Wheels.